Creation in the Prophetic Literature, Part 2. We've been discussing the Genesis account of origins, two books that recently came out, 2015, the Genesis creation account and its reverberations in the Old Testament, and He Spoke and It Was, Divine Creation in the Old Testament, basically going over the same ground, one in a more scholarly level and one in a more popular level. That's what the books look like. We are currently on Chapter 8, Part 2, which is entitled Creation in the Prophetic Literature of the Old Testament, an Intertextual Approach. It's written by Martin Klingbeil, and if that name sounds familiar, yes, he is the son of the editor. The brother of the editor. He's based in Southern Adventist University in Tennessee and also in Stellenbosch University in South Africa. And I'll have more to say about that in just a minute. I said that last week, so I'm going to say it again. He actually wrote this up before as a... an article. And so when they went to write the book, they thought, well, fine, let's get him to write up the new chapter as well. Last week we talked about Jonah, Amos, Hosea, Michael, and Isaiah. And this week we're going to talk about Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Joel, Jeremiah, and then the post-exilic prophets, Ezekiel, Obadiah, Daniel, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. The 7th century BC prophets, this is just at the time of the fall of, or just before the fall of Judah. And we begin... with the comment that a new century in the prophetic literature of the Old Testament was overshadowed by the sobering prospective of the fall of Samaria and an increasing urgency for the prophetic message to be heard as the Babylonian exile was approaching. As during the 8th century BC, the prophetic word was often introduced with an international message, as was the case with the words issued by Nahum against the Assyrians. Habakkuk entered with God into a dialogue about his people, while Zephaniah and Joel enlarged upon the eschatological meaning of the Day of the Lord motif. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, and his message ultimately failed in averting the Babylonian exile. Starting with Nahum, creation in Nahum is connected to the Day of the Lord, and the description of its characteristics is reminiscent of creation terminology. He rebukes the sea, and it dries up. He makes all the rivers run dry. Bashan and Carmel wither, and the blossoms of Lebanon fade. The mountains quake before him, and the hills melt away. The earth trembles at his presence, the world and all who live in it. It's kind of cosmic in scope. It doesn't say anything specifically about creation. As he puts it, again, there is a context of decreation which is driven by cosmological imagery. In the judgment theophany, the created order is impacted by its own creator in a way that is reminiscent of the ancient Near East Chaoskampf motif, where there is a polemic reworking of the motif with Yahweh being depicted as the sovereign over all the common ancient Near Eastern power symbols such as the sea, the mountains, and the earth. And that's all he says about Nahum, so Nahum doesn't really figure very much. Habakkuk offers a perspective on creation similar to Nahum's in using creation imagery in the context of decreation during the theophany in the Day of the Lord. He stood and shook the earth. He looked and made the nations tremble. The ancient mountains crumbled and the age-old hills collapsed. But he marches on forever. In the following verses, Habakkuk describes the impact of Yahweh's appearance on creation. However, through the destructive power of decreation, salvation is accomplished. You came out to deliver your people, to save your anointed one. Along the same lines, creation imagery also serves as a point of reference for recognition of the Creator. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Now, I think you have to push that hard to get creation out of that. There is a passage where he speaks about the heavens and the earth using the same terminology as in Genesis 1. But again, Habakkuk, you'd have a hard time figuring out exactly where he stood on creation, except that if you know that the creation account was before him, you would say he probably accepts it. Zephaniah, as observed earlier, Zephaniah 1:3 introduces a decreation theme by listing the animals in an order that is the exact reverse of the order in which they were originally mentioned in Genesis 1. He furthermore uses the familiar wordplay between Adam, man, and Adama, which is ground, from Genesis 2:7. However, the reversal of creation transmits a strong theological message. In Genesis 2, quoting, in Genesis 2, however, the pun is used to indicate man's dependence on that from whence he came, whereas Zephaniah uses it to show man's separation from his creator, Yahweh. A situation that involves a return to the age before creation can result only in man's destruction. Zephaniah is depicting the progressive loss of dominion over creation by humanity and its resulting decreation. Aside from the obvious creation allusions, Zephaniah also refers to another event of the Ergeshkishki, that is, the flood, by using the phrase "from the face of the earth" as an inclusio for the passage in Zephaniah 1:1-3. Compare Genesis 6:7, 7:4, and 8:8. And I looked those up, and in fact, the Hebrew does speak of Pene Adama, the face of the ground. So it's a precise verbal correspondence there. Within the prophet's message of judgment, the flood serves as an example of present impending doom. I should probably stop here and note that that the flood has been conceived as a decreation, where all that had been done at creation was reversed, and finally you had simply the sea, the deep, if you prefer, covering the entire land. So that there is a, if the flood is a decreation, then if you allude to decreation, you're alluding to the flood as well as to creation itself. Joel. Within the day of the Lord imagery, Joel employs creation imagery in order to describe the impact of Yahweh's theophany on creation as part of that judgment day. The sun and the moon will be darkened and the stars will no longer shine, which is the reverse of day 4. The Lord will roar from Zion and thunder from Jerusalem. The earth and the heavens will tremble. But the Lord will be a refuge for his people, a stronghold for the people of Israel. The merism heavens and earth serve as a creation indicator, but again within a negative context of judgment. The theophanic event is always connected to the experience of God in nature and the impact of his appearance on creation. However, the final verses of Joel return to the topic of recreation, describing the future of Zion in paradisical terms. In that day, the mountains will drip new wine, and the hills will flow with milk. All the ravines of Judah will run with water. A fountain will flow out of the Lord's house and will water the valley of Acacias. Joel 3:18, and the Masoretic text is chapter 4, verse 18. The Garden of Eden, mentioned earlier on, and you may wonder what that is. I'll cover that in just a minute. That has been destroyed by the locust plague is thus being recreated. Again, a linear motion from creation to decreation and finally to recreation can be observed, with creation being the overall paradigm that underlies history. And there's the text. A fire devoureth before them, this is the locust, of course, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is as the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. And so you have the locusts that are basically uncreating or decreating the Garden of Eden. And the Garden of Eden is referenced nowhere else that I know of other than in Genesis, chapters 1 and 2, particularly chapter 2. So this is a clear allusion to Genesis. Otherwise, when Joel says it's like the Garden of Eden, how are they supposed to take that? Whereas with the Genesis account, it's perfectly understandable. Jeremiah. Creation is so omnipresent in Jeremiah that we will have to limit ourselves to a number of key passages. The book begins with a reference to the creation of the prophet in his mother's womb. Jeremiah 1:5, using the lexical creation marker Yatsar to form or fashion, which is what a potter would do, and which was done in Genesis 2:7. The creation of humankind as part of the creation week is repeated in every new creation of new human life. So creation now has a broader theme. A survey of creation in Jeremiah has to include Jeremiah 4:23 through 26, which connects with strong linguistic markers to the creation account as found in Genesis 1. The Oracle of Doom presents possibly the most faithful account of decreation, or the reversal of creation, when compared with Genesis 1:2 to 2:4a. The following table, adopted from Michael Fishbane's work, shows the progression. We'll show you the table, but first I want to read you the passage briefly. I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form and void. And for those of you who are interested, that's tohu or bohu. The very words that are used in Genesis 1:2. And the heavens, by the way, one of the only three passages in the entire Bible where bohu is used. The other one being Isaiah, which we talked about last week a little bit, and also has a creation or a decreation, as in Jeremiah, theme. And the heavens, and they had no light. I beheld the mountains, and lo, they trembled, and all the hills moved lightly. I beheld, and lo, there was no man, and all the birds of heaven were fled. I beheld, and lo, the fruitful place was a wilderness, and all the cities there were broken down at the presence of the Lord and by his fierce anger. And here's the comparison. Pre-creation, formless and empty, tohu wabohu, identical in both passages. Notice in the first day there was light, and now in Jeremiah there's no light. The second day it talks about the heavens, the Shemayim, and in the second day in Jeremiah it also has the heavens. For the third day we talk about the dry ground, Eretz, and it talks about the earth, Eretz, in Jeremiah. The fourth day, there's no real comparison, although the idea of the fourth day, that there should be lights, if there is no light, then there are no lights, of course. Fifth day, the birds had fled. The word birds are identical, wolf or winged creatures. And then, of course, there were no people. And interesting, there were no people. It is actually Adam. man, or Adam, if you prefer. Let us make mankind. Let's make man in our image. And then finally, instead of the Sabbath in Genesis 2, 2, and 3, you have the towns destroyed before his fierce anger. So they are now no longer nobody, you know, the land is at rest, but for the precise opposite reason. While the Genesis account ends with the day of rest, the Sabbath, Jeremiah's decreation count, ends with a day of fury. The deconstruction of creation is taking place, and one can be sure that the listeners and subsequent readers of the prophet's message recognized the creation pattern. Creation becomes the paradigm for destruction and serves as the primeval point of departure for contemporary theology. What acts and words could be more invested with power than those of creation? The antithesis to the doom oracle is provided in Jeremiah 31, 35 through 37, where two short sayings conclude the so-called Book of Comfort, which is Jeremiah 30 and 31. And in creation language point to the impossibility of Yahweh destroying Israel. Yet it is expressed along the lines of remnant theology with reference to the seed of Israel and its future hope. Both apparent opposite expressions, Jeremiah 4, 23 and 26, and Jeremiah 31, 35 through 37, show the range of possible applications of creation theology within Jeremiah. But beyond that, they show that Israel needs to acknowledge Yahweh with regard to their present future. Thus, both extremes of expression bear witness to the theological claim that finally Israel must come to terms with Yahweh, on whom its future well-being solely depends. Jeremiah 10, 12 through 16 is a hymn that celebrates Yahweh's creative power, and it is replete with creation imagery. But God made the earth by his power. He founded the world by his wisdom and stretched out the heavens by his understanding. When he thunders, the waters in the heavens roar. He makes clouds arise from the ends of the earth. He sends lightning with rain and brings out the wind from his storehouses. And I think this passage gives some support to the idea that God moving around in massive ways is reminiscent of creation, and that is founded upon the fact that he created them in the first place. Interestingly, you'll notice that he founded the earth by his world by his wisdom and stretched out the heavens by his understanding. Very reminiscent of the passage in Proverbs that we studied a couple weeks ago, suggesting that for Jeremiah, Proverbs was in the past, at least the beginning of Proverbs. To continue the passage, everyone is senseless and without knowledge. Every goldsmith is shamed by his idols. The image he makes, a fraud. They have no breath in them. I would have put an R in there, but this is what the original has in the book. They are worthless, the objects of mockery. When their judgment comes, they will perish. He who is the portion of Jacob is not like these, for he is the maker of all things, including Israel, the people of his inheritance. The Lord Almighty is his name. By the way, the very beginning of that passage, the verse before what we started reading, talks about the idols who can't make anything, suggesting a contrast with the portion of Jacob, who is the maker of all things. Although most commentators point to the contrast between the true God and the idols, the emphasis is rather on a contrast between Yahweh as the creator of life and humankind as false creators of life, which is a little bit different focus. The focus is not on the idol, but on its maker, humankind, who is shamed by his inanimate image, since he is not able to provide the creature with the necessary breath of life, which is the distinguishing characteristic of Yahweh's creation. Which means that from the Bible itself, you can argue that humans are not going to create life in the full sense of the word. Idolatry is therefore a double sin. The worship of idols denies the reality of God's complete control over the cosmos because it involves the acknowledgement of other divine powers, Worse still is the pretense of creating life. In so doing, humankind lays claim to divine knowledge. And by the way, that ellipsis is in the original. Sixth and fifth century prophets, the Babylonian exile and post-exilic period caused a change in the prophetic message, shifting their themes towards restoration and recreation. While Ezekiel and Obadiah witnessed the downfall of Jerusalem, and as such the ultimate fulfillment of the long prophesied decreation, Daniel brings an apocalyptic dimension to the topic. Recreation becomes a prominent theme for post-exilic Haggai and Zechariah, and Malachi finalizes the canonical prophetic chorus of the Old Testament with a restorative message centered on the second Elijah. Ezekiel. David L. Peterson comes to the conclusion that creation traditions are not important for Ezekiel's theological argument. However, his assertion appears to be based on the assumption of an exclusive positive reading of the creation account, which as has been seen, forms only one part of the theological panorama for which creation motifs were invoked. There is also decreation and recreation. If understood in this way, Ezekiel is not concerned with how the world itself came into existence, but rather with reforming a world gone awry. In order to illustrate this, I will focus on three passages that outline Ezekiel's theological use of creation. Ezekiel 28:11-19 is a prophetic oracle that centers on a description of the king of Tyre. Most of you are familiar with this. As a type for the anarchic cherub, which has been interpreted since patristic times as pointing to the fall of Lucifer. A number of indicative creation linguistic markers are present, yet the context of the passage is focused on the description of the hubris of a fallen angel who is staining a perfect world. As with Jeremiah, creation language is employed as a powerful paradigm to describe the origin of sin. Ezekiel 31:1-18 transfers the same scenario into the realm of human history. The cosmic tree, which refers to the king of Assyria at first and then later to the king of Egypt, represents human kingship, a motif well known from ancient Near East iconography, and is used as a metaphor for the downfall of the king of Syria, which in turn serves as a warning for Egypt's future judgment. And the cosmic tree is connected to the tree of life. The chapter describes the glory of the tree within creation terminology and cosmology. For example, Tehom in Ezekiel 3:14 and Genesis 7:11. And of course, to home in Genesis 1:2 as well, and connects it with paradise. Creation terminology is employed to describe the downfall of two prominent nations, Assyria and Egypt. Thus, not only paradise, but also human history has been spoiled. Recreation in Ezekiel and the reversal of decreation, as exemplified by the two previous passages, can be found in Ezekiel 47:1-12, this is the vision of Ezekiel where there's a river coming out of Zion, and as Ezekiel wades in, it gets deeper and deeper until finally it's beyond what he can wade through. He has to swim. Within the context of the vision of the future glory of the temple, which in itself serves as a creation motif. Normally, I would say that's stretching it, but there is a reasonable argument from temple theology that creation figures into the temple itself. This time, the trees are growing again, not in rebellion against, but under Yahweh's power and provision of fertility. The sustaining agents of God's power are the rivers of paradise, which connect Ezekiel to the creation account in Genesis 2:10-14. You may remember that the river of life went out and split into four different rivers with an extensive description of a couple of them. Ezekiel deliberately merges temple in Zion with paradise imagery because the destruction of the earthly temple in Jerusalem and his own exile in Babylon has caused the place of God's presence to transcend to a heavenly realm, indicating that Yahweh's presence is continuous and does not depend on human realities. As the connections between Ezekiel 47, 1 through 12, and Genesis 2, 10 through 14 reveal, Ezekiel understood the symbol of Zion in a new way, cut free from explicit references to the temporal political realities of kingship, priesthood, and the earthly temple. The Temple Mount and river of Ezekiel's last great vision stand as timeless symbols of divine presence. For Ezekiel, the earthly Zion with its city and temple was a bitter disappointment. Of interest, one of the things that happens in Ezekiel in this vision is that the leaves have medicinal properties of the trees along the river. And that theme, of course, is picked up in Revelation and reemphasized by the leaves are for the healing of the nations of the tree of life. Creation in Ezekiel is used to express God's and the prophets' disappointment over angelic rebellion and consequent human history, which replays that rebellion again and again. However, the prophet moves beyond that in stating that God is able to recreate something new and eternal from the shreds of human history. At the same time, one should be cautious not to attribute an exclusive otherworldliness to Ezekiel's prophecies. Obadiah. No explicit creation terminology is employed in the book of Obadiah except for the usage of the Mount Zion motif. Now, to me, that's pretty thin gruel, so I'm going to skip over the rest of what he says in Obadiah. Daniel. Few studies engage the book of Daniel with creation theology, and those who take up the task usually focus on the mythological Chaos Kampf motif and its ancient Near Eastern counterparts, as found in the description of the waters in Daniel 7, 2, and 3. According to Robert R. Wilson, in contrast to Genesis 1, the waters described in Daniel 7 are presented as returning to chaos, and the animals that surface from the waters are composite creatures that do not correspond to the order of creation in Genesis 1. So there's really no creation. The world has reverted to its pre-creation state and is clearly in need of recreation. This recreation is achieved in the vision of the Ancient One, who constitutes the second part of the vision with the word sultan or dominion as the key word that appears 8 times in this chapter. The failure of human dominion over the earth in history as envisioned in creation is replaced by God's dominion over the universe through an everlasting kingdom. But apart from Daniel 7, there are more references to creation in the prophetic book, as demonstrated by Jacques Ducan. Approaching the issue from a linguistic perspective, he arrives at the conclusion that, and I'm not going to read that, any of you that read French are welcome to try, but I will translate it for you. Allusions to creation abound throughout the book and are attested in one way or another in each of its chapters. In the following, I have included the most significant allusions highlighted by Ducan. In Daniel 1:12, the four young men opt for a menu, which echoes the pre-fall diet found in Genesis 1:29. While the description of Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel 2:38 involves terminology when it employs creation terminology, when it employs the same attribute of dominion over the earth and all its creatures to the Babylonian king as Adam received in Genesis 1:28. Clay, which is part of the statue's feet, is used throughout the Bible in context alluding to creation, including indicating the religious aspect of the spiritual realm. And I'll read Isaiah 29:16, and also Daniel 2:38. This is the description of Genesis. The description that comes from Nebuchadnezzar's "Thou art this head of gold." Just before that, it says, "Wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven, hath he given into thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them all." So you can see the clear allusion to Genesis, Genesis 1, where man was given dominion. The potter theme is very clearly connected to creation in Isaiah 29:16. Surely your turnings of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. For shall the work say of him who that made it, he made me not? Or shall the theme framed say of him that framed it, he hath no understanding? That's a fairly clear allusion to creation in Isaiah. And of course, made out of clay or ground. Those two are fairly closely similar terms in Hebrew in terms of their content, and are used in parallel in some of the poetic language that we've seen before. The word pair hosek and or, darkness and light, in Daniel's benediction echoes the creation account of Genesis 1, 4, and 5. Remember, separate the light from the darkness. Another creation word pair, Shemayim and Eretz, heaven and earth, is found in Nebuchadnezzar's prayer after he returns to his senses in Daniel 4, 35. Furthermore, the use of the cosmic tree motif in Daniel 4 points to the creation account, as we've seen previously for Ezekiel. And just for reference, this is Daniel 2's thankfulness. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. That's the whole second or, light and darkness and light. And chapter 4, verse 35, and this is part of Nebuchadnezzar's prayer. And all the inhabitants of the earth are as reputed as nothing, and he doeth, that is God, doeth according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what doest thou? And I think the army of heaven there is Saba, which is the same word actually that's used at the end of Genesis 2. Or, pardon me, at the beginning of Genesis 2, just after the account of creation, and just before the Sabbath itself. And then, if you're wondering about the tree motif, here it is in Genesis 2:9. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The combination of two segulates, Arab boker, evening, morning, in Daniel 8:14, that should be a familiar text to most Adventists, for 2,300 evenings and mornings, Arab boker, is found in this sentence, following each other in close proximity, well, right next to each other, and with the same associated meaning only in the creation story. And it was evening and it was morning, day one. In the concluding chapter of the book, Daniel evokes creation terminology by describing recreation, which is taking place after decreation scenario of the previous chapter. For the righteous ones, there's a passage from sleeping in the dust. Remember, that's where people go when they die, in Genesis 3, and it's where people were created from at the beginning, or at least Adam was, and to shining like the stars. And for Daniel in particular, there's a passage from resting to standing up in the final day to receive his inheritance in chapter 12, verse 13. The apocalyptic themes of the transformation of history and the final return to an Edenic state that are so recurrent in the book of Daniel are theologically grouped along a continuum from creation to decreation and finally recreation, a topic that we have encountered repeatedly in the prophetic literature of the Old Testament, whereas the timelines in Daniel are broader and informed by his apocalyptic perspective. Eschatology, which moves towards an end, imperatively necessitates a beginning, and the theme of creation provides the theological rationale against which eschatology can take place. Now, moving on to Haggai. In Haggai 1:10, the prophet invokes the heavens and earth merism, demonstrating how post-exilic community's lack of faithfulness is causing nature's or creation's blessing to be interrupted. Further on, Haggai employs the same word pair in order to describe how the created order is affected by the day of the Lord, but this time from a messianic perspective. Haggai states, "This is what the Lord Almighty says, in a little while I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land." Heavens and earth being one pair, and the sea and the dry land being a pair that harks back to Genesis, the third day of creation. "I will shake all nations, and what is desired by all nations will come, and I will fill this house," meaning the temple, "with glory," says the Lord Almighty. Haggai 1:10, "Therefore the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit." And there's, you see the pair of heaven and earth. Zechariah describes God as the continuous sustainer of creation. "Ask the Lord for rain in the springtime. It is the Lord who sends the thunderstorms. He gives showers of rain to all people and plants of the field to everyone. The Eseb Basadeh, vegetation in the field, with particle ba meaning in front of the sadeh, connects with the Eseb Hasadeh, vegetation of the field, of Genesis 2:5. Almost the same verbs, or almost the same verbiage. Springtime and fertility are caused by the ongoing process of creating Asa, the rain clouds. Zechariah's second oracle is introduced by using a distinctive creation terminology, however, with a significant rearranging of the various elements. "The word of the Lord concerning Israel, the Lord who stretches out the heavens, who lays the foundation of the earth, who forms the human spirit within a person," declares. And of course, that's a human spirit that's being formed, not the human itself. While the stretching out of the heavens is not a direct linguistic creation marker, it nevertheless recaptures the action of Genesis 1, 6, and 7 and is found throughout the Old Testament. And there's a bunch of texts that refer to that in connection to creation. It is also interesting to note that the object of Yatsar form in Zechariah 12:1 is not man himself, as in Genesis 2:7, but Ruach Adam, the spirit of man. One has the sense that there is a traditional set of creation vocabulary, but it could be arranged in various acceptable patterns. Heavens, earth, humanity, and spirit provide the crucial building blocks. Zechariah 12:1 combines them into an innovative and adroit manner. Interestingly, Zechariah 12:1 serves within the given literary genre as a validation for the following oracle, which is a description of Israel's new and victorious role among the nations, a new creation of the nation on the day of the Lord. Malachi. Malachi concludes the cycle of the Old Testament prophets with a rhetorical question, which links the God as creator metaphor to the God as father metaphor. Do we not all have one father? Did not one God create us? And of course, that's a parallel and has distinctly creation in it. Why do we profane the covenant of our ancestors by being unfaithful to one another? And interestingly, the unfaithfulness is in marriage, which was a creation sacrament. Creation is here being elevated to the intimate level of a father-son relationship and a husband-wife relationship, which echoes the intimate creation account of Genesis 2. Creation in the last book of the Old Testament and in its final analysis is not, that's an awkward sentence, is not centered on cosmogony, but on a personal relationship between God and humanity, as already hinted at in the order of creation. Summary and conclusion, the following synopsis highlights the most prominent dimensions of creation motifs and links in the writings of the Old Testament prophets. I'm going to just give part of this. In trying to establish the broader lines of creation in the prophetic literature of the 8th century BC, it becomes apparent that creation is progressively anchored in history, theologically made relevant in salvation, and paradigmatically centered in the introduction of the triad of creation, decreation, and recreation. Creation in the prophetic literature of the 7th century BC is historically contextualized by the impending Babylonian exile, whereas the triad of creation, decreation, and recreation becomes more prominent with the prophets beginning to look beyond the inevitable judgment and towards restoration. The use of creation during the final 2 centuries of the Old Testament prophetic literature is clearly future-oriented, whereas a theological abstraction has taken place that can be related to the disappearance of the physical temple and monarchy. While creation is still the overarching paradigm that spans human history, the focus has moved toward the end of that arch, which, as in the case of the book of Daniel, takes on apocalyptic and also messianic notions. Creation in the prophetic literature of the Old Testament is employed as a constant literary and theological reference, which connects to a historical past, motivates the interpretation of the present, and moves towards a perspective for the future by means of a continuous contextualization of the topic via the triad, creation, decreation, and recreation. This reference point is anchored in the creation account as found in Genesis 1 through 3. The final authors of the Hebrew Bible understood creation not as one topic among others, or even one of the lower significance. For them, creation was the starting point because everything human beings can think and say about God and his relationship to the world and to humankind depends on the fact that he created all this. The intertextual markers that refer to creation in the prophets indicate they saw creation as a literal and historical given, whereas references made indiscriminately to the creation account as presented in both Genesis 1 and 2. The intertextual movement indicates clearly that as much as creation forms the starting point of much of the prophetic theological discourse, all markers of creation as discussed in this study point back to the creation model presented in Genesis 1 through 3. While it has not been the purpose of the present study to reconstruct the cosmology of the Old Testament prophets, it has become apparent that creation was the point of departure for their worldview. They clearly explained and interpreted the world from this perspective. Any discussion of whether the prophets considered creation anything other than a historical event, or even that they only used it for literary or theological purposes, cannot be sustained from the textual data and would be projecting a 19th century AD rationalistic debate into a first millennium BC context. And that last point, I think, is a profound one. Now, my take, I think that broadly speaking, Martin Klingbeil is right that there are multiple allusions to creation in the prophets. Some of the allusions reach, such as the Mount Zion reference is in Obadiah. I'm not sure that I can go with him very far on that one. Some of them would not be convincing to one predisposed to doubt, such as the references in Habakkuk. One could always try to say, well, heaven and earth is just the biggest thing they've got, and so therefore they went there instead of alluding to creation itself. Some, I think, are absolutely convincing, such as the references in Isaiah, and which we talked about last week, and especially Jeremiah, which we talked about this week. One can only put the Genesis account late by a methodological insistence on its being late, and even then one must allow for a developing story that is finalized and not invented out of whole cloth late. Verbal markers strongly suggest that the language itself, not just the outlines of the story, was already developed by the time of Jeremiah, if not Isaiah, and by Isaiah I mean the first part of Isaiah, which is accepted as pre-exilic by virtually everyone today. Klingbeil ignores the usual skeptical questions about Jonah and Daniel. Interestingly enough, he notes the questions about Isaiah, but argues from creation references, among other things, that Isaiah is a literary unity. This may or may not be the best way to deal with these issues, but it is certainly one way, and maybe given the limitations in space, a reasonable way, and I agree with his conclusions. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Well, we have one comment here.
We'll see. In Genesis 2:3, God blessed the seventh day and made it holy because on it he rested from all, and then I read someplace that said he rested from all the creation that he made to create. In other words, what he did in creation, he meant to just recreate itself after its kind. So my question is, wherever I read that, was that a fair statement according to Genesis 2:3?
Well, you know, it's very interesting because this forms the backdrop for a controversy between Jesus and the Pharisees of his day, where Jesus is doing something on the Sabbath, and he doesn't argue, well, it's permissible work on the Sabbath. Maybe he does indirectly, but he argues that that my Father is always working and I'm still working, implying that it isn't the end. And interestingly, the term Yahweh is not the Hifael perfect, which you would expect as something that, you know, he did it in the past and that's the end of it. It's actually the one who continues to create. So I think we need to be a little bit careful about saying that God rested from everything he did and he's been unemployed ever since. It would be interesting, since we have the ability to do that, let's pull up the... let's see if I can get this to work here. Maybe if I can make this smaller. Bible Gateway. No, that's not what I wanted to do. I want to get this. Yeah, there we go. And then I'm going to scroll up and we're going to change this to let's see. There it is. I had it right there. The Westminster Leningrad Codex, which is the Hebrew. And I think I can do this. We'll find out. This would be Genesis 2, right?
Yes.
So, Genesis 2:3, right?
Yes.
And blessed God. God blessed the day, the seventh. And he made it holy because, in it he rested Shabbat, which of course is where we get Sabbath, from all his malakut, his work which he created. These are two different words. It's not his creation which he created, it's his work which he created. Malakah is kind of standard form for work. I mean, you find it used for ordinary work for everybody else, which God created to make, which is kind of an interesting way of phrasing it. Yeah, It's interesting. It does say he created. It does use the verb bara, and it does interesting also have the verb to make as well. I think from reading that you'd be a little bit, you'd be pushing it just a little bit to try to make it into and he quit, and he expected it to go on from there on its own. Yeah. We have a Hebrew scholar here.
But I don't have my Hebrew Bible.
Pardon me? Mike, your
what
mic.
What do we have there?
Can we hear you?
Oh. Which God created to do. I think that is probably, that's an infinitive.
Yeah, it is.
It is the idea, I would get, that he created it in doing it, by doing it, to do it, and he created and did. It's sort of the two go together.
Yeah. It's almost, I think I've seen one translation that said he created and made, and that's not that far off.
No. We've got the creation and the making all as sort of one thing. But people want to read what they want to read.
That's a real problem in biblical studies. It's very easy to read into the text things that you want to see.
If you think it's that way, you find it.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like it's pretty clear what the prophets believed in a creation. They even use words that look like they came straight out of Genesis 1. You couldn't recreate Genesis 1 or create it in the first place from those prophetic utterances. I mean, I couldn't take Jeremiah and redo it and come up with the Genesis 1. But on the other hand, if you have Genesis 1, where Jeremiah is coming from is perfectly obvious. And last week, where Isaiah was coming from is also, I think, perfectly obvious. And I think that this points to the idea that the Genesis account is anterior to first Isaiah. Which means to put it down in supposedly the priestly code and put the priestly code even at the exile, let alone after the restoration, I think it's only done because people believe that the theology has to get better and better and better with time.
And because they don't want to believe creation.
And because they don't want to believe in miracles, and creation is the biggest miracle of all.
For a total amateur, not knowing the language, I can see how people are drawn. You're intelligent, and you can read that, and I say, okay, you know what you're doing. Someone else reads it, and they say something, and I say, okay, they know what they're doing. So I got to fall back on something else. And that something else for me is the whole Bible, and as an Adventist, Ellen White. Not that I prove anything by her, but she sure has kept my mind within the bounds over time. So, you know, nothing like a good theologian to really mess things up. And nothing like a good theologian to really clear things up either. So
yeah.
For amateurs like me, you know, this kind of thing is good.
Yeah. Well, I think that's a very important point. We have been gifted in this age with the ability to look things up and to go back to the originals as much as possible. And we can have, you know, go back to basics and rethink stuff. But what about the people who start out, in your case, you're one of them, without having all of that background? Where do you go for your authority? And, you know, it raises some very interesting questions. I would just put one thing out that I think is important, and that is, there is value in conservatism. There is value in believing things until you can prove otherwise, rather than assuming that the people who came before you don't know anything. I remember Abby Hoffman saying, don't trust anybody over 30. And this, of course, was at the time when he was about 22 or something like that. And I remember thinking, what's he going to do when he gets 8 years out? And sure enough, he asked for an exception for himself. You know, it's very interesting, because this is the precise point that Eve has. God says, if you eat of it, you die. Somebody else comes along and says, no, it's not going to happen. Look, I'm eating it. I'm not dead yet. And besides that, it'll make you smarter. I used to not be able to talk. I can talk now. And what is Eve supposed to do? Because she's never done experiments on snakes and fed them, you know, half of them little bits of, you know, and see what happens after, you know, do they die after sundown or something like that. I mean, it's there are sometimes when you can't do all the experiments yourself. And then you're going to have to ask yourself some really tough questions about who do you believe and why. And I guess I'm a little on the conservative side. When somebody else starts out saying that this is true, if you have two people disputing it, the first guy in probably has a slight edge. Comment back here.
I was intrigued about the days of creation in Jeremiah 4. Last time I mentioned, when we talked about Jonah, we have the 7 days of creation there. Yes. Looks like Jeremiah 4 has almost all the 7 days except the fourth day. I was surprised that Klingbeil didn't then leap over to Jeremiah 31, which he did later, and mention that the fourth day is strongly alluded to with the covenant and the day and the night and the sun and the moon will not depart, because they're part of an everlasting covenant. And the basis of God's covenant with his people is the covenant with the skies and the heavenly orbs, that they will never fail. And that covenant had to have been made at creation, right? On the fourth day, because they were given rulership.
Yes.
Over day and night, and that rulership was never removed.
And the only other creature that has rulership is man, interestingly.
Exactly. And so in Jeremiah...
And by the way, it's the same word, Mashal.
Hey, that's right. In Jeremiah 31, we have the covenant with the day and night, and then it's repeated in Jeremiah 34, showing that it's a very, very important concept. And so when you put all that together, you have a nice package of the 7 days of creation, Jeremiah 4.
I think you have a very good point there, and that is that although it's not all in that one place, there's a very clear allusion to every single day.
There is. More so than any of the other of the later prophets.
Yeah.
You probably could find it in Isaiah, I'm not sure, but certainly Jeremiah is clear on that.
Well, Jeremiah is either the longest or the second longest, depending on how you count it, prophet.
That's true. Yeah.
And so, and Isaiah is the other one, so yeah. It's not surprising that they have more about creation.
Exactly. One other thought, the tohu vabohu, that concept actually crops up in a lot of the minor prophets. One of the first ones we dealt with today was Nahum, and it speaks about God rebuking the sea and drying up the rivers, and the mountains quake before him. Part of Jeremiah's view of the tohu vabohu is the mountains quaking. He says, I beheld the mountains, and indeed they trembled.
Mm-hmm.
So you have that, and then you have the absence of life and absence of fruition. In Nahum, it says, Bashan and Carmel wither. Those are that's the breadbasket of Palestine, especially with a lot of fruits. And the flower of Lebanon wilts. And then in Jeremiah 4, it talks about the fruitful place being torn down. And so you have a lot of similar concepts. And I wish the author had drawn dotted lines more between these, because it makes a much stronger case.
I think you're right that that although the word bohu is not specifically used, some of those places there you actually have tohu. But more importantly, even if you don't have the word, you have the concept of you know, completely waste. And I think that you can argue that that is decreation. And interestingly enough, that same concept comes up during the millennium.
So is it legitimate to take these passages in Jeremiah and read them back into Genesis and try and reconstruct what might have been here prior to day one? I think there's a big danger of that, because you come up with a gap theory. I mean, the full-fledged gap theory. And certainly Evanus and many conservative Christians totally reject the gap theory, which I do too. The full-fledged gap
theory. The active gap.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The active gap. Passive gap, well, how much can we read into that, you know? Probably not very much.
More importantly, how much should we read into it?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, anyway, next week we will continue our saga through the Old Testament, and we will on June, I think it's June 11, we should be having a discussion of the Rakia with a response from Fritz Guy and Brian Bull, and it should be, I think, an interesting and informative discussion.